move on to the last speaker of the session, Sergio Ferrara, who will tell us about the embedding of the Starobinsky model in supergravity.
Thank you. I also would like to thank you, the organizer, for inviting me. I have 8 publications with Riccardo Barbieri. I saw the in the archives. There is one which is which has been, at least looking at the references, much more influential than the others. And this is the paper I wrote with him, I think, in 82, which is about spontaneous symmetry breaking coming from gravitational effects. This is what in modern language is called, I think, supergravity mediated supersymmetry breaking. But at the time, it was a particular limit of a supersymmetric theory coupled to gravity, where the mass, the Planck mass get large, but the gravitino mass is fixed. So in that way, you get soft breaking terms, which were later used in the application of the minimal of supersymmetry to the minimal to the standard model. Well, in supersymmetry, of course, one of the main prediction is that one should think about the existence of fundamental fields because of multiplets of supersymmetry. Unfortunately, one fundamental field has been already discovered at CERN, which is the Higgs. Although his light mass give the belief that there should be supersymmetry behind. However, supersymmetry is pushed in the TV region, and then we will probably have at least to wait for the second generation of experiment at maximal LHC energy to discover supersymmetry. However, especially talking with my friends and collaborators at Stanford, Renata Kalosh and Andre Linde, well, they told me that actually, if you believe in the present cosmology, there is another fundamental field in the game, and this fundamental field is the inflaton. So, in some sense, from cosmology comes the role of fundamental fields in an entirely different region, reasons of the Higgs. Although there are models in which are called Higgs inflation, where in fact this particle are identified. Well, since we apply supersymmetry to the standard model, it's not, and in fact has been, there has been a lot of activity of applying supersymmetry to cosmology. And of course, if one applies supersymmetry to cosmology, supergravity plays, of course, an important role, because cosmology is a theory where gravity is the main ingredient of the discussion. Well, my since I don't want to give for reason of time a long, I will try just to give you some hint of what is related to the work I'm going to talk about. And this work is work which I've done in the last summer with different collaboration in 2 papers with Carlos Linde and Massimo Borretti, another paper with Van Proyen, and late paper with Frey and Sorin. Sorin is a physicist in Russia, Dubna, and Frey is actually in Russia because he's the Italian attaché, at the Italian embassy in Moscow. Actually, I have also the nice thing that 2 years ago I went to one of these workshops that these people organized, and I happened to meet Starobinsky in that occasion. Well, the reason why the title of this talk is called Supersymmetric Extension of the Starobinsky Model It's because there is a particular simple model of the inflation, which is called the Sarabinsky model, which actually became popular, especially after the release of the Planck data, which is in fact an extremely simple explanation, which justify a particular potential for the inflaton, even if this explanation looks naive and very simple-minded. So I will tell you what is this explanation of giving a particular inflaton potential, which, however, is compatible with the data on cosmological prediction, and what is the extension of this to supersymmetry, which has some interesting aspect by itself. Well, in these theories, the Sarabinsky model is actually a model where, you know, the problem with the inflaton is to understand what is the origin of the scalar field. Well, in this Sarabinsky model, the inflaton is identified with what Sarabinsky has called scalaron. And the scalaron is a purely gravitational degree of freedom, which is actually dual to a standard canonical field with a particular potential. This degree of freedom comes essentially adding to the Einstein term, a term which is quadratic in the curvature of the gravitational field. The weak point about this argument is that this term quadratic in the curvature has to be chosen in a particular way, otherwise you introduce a ghost in the theory. But I will tell you, I will explain you how this term and what are the degrees of freedom that this term introduce. There were some cosmology talks in this conference, but since only Dvali has talked about these numbers, I want just to tell you what is, from a cosmological point of view, the relation of the inflaton potential to the measure quantities. There is a nice review which is called Encyclopedia Inflationaris by Martin Ringeval and Benin, where all these cosmological parameter and all these quantities are given. But let me tell you that for the thing I'm going to talk, the relevant cosmological parameter are called epsilon and eta. These were introduced by Dvali today. They are related to particular combination of the derivative of the potential, ratio of derivative of the potential. And then there is this number, capital N, which is a number of a folding, which is also given by formula in terms of the potential. And then the measure quantities, which are related to this spectral index of scalar perturbation and the ratio of tensor to scalar perturbation in terms of this parameter is given here. And for a class of models, which Carlos and Linde call attractors, because they are models which give the same prediction for this parameter as in the Sarabinsky model, this number in terms of this number of befolding for large n is given by this formula here. And this b is the coefficient of this exponent. And in the case of the Sarabinsky model, b squared is actually equal to third. This is a magic number, which, however, can be understood from the way the Sarabinsky model is derived. It's interesting that in the case of supersymmetry, this number b squared will be related to the curvature of a particular Kerr manifold, which has to do with the supersymmetric completion of this model. Well, let me give you a very brief discussion of this higher quadratic term in gravity. We are working in four dimensions. The quadratic term you add are this term which have coefficient alpha and beta. One is the square of the scalar curvature, and the other is the square of the right tensor. There is no other term because the extra term is related to the previous one by the Gauss-Bonnet theorem. And the spectrum, if you take this theory, what happens is that this theory has a certain number of excitation. It has a massless graviton, but it has additional massive states. There is a spin 2 massive state, which is a ghost, with mass which is essentially 1 over beta, is gamma over beta. And there is a spinless particle, which is a non-ghost with mass gamma over 12 alpha, and alpha and beta are taken to be negative and positive in the two cases. Well, the Starobinsky model is essentially the model which put beta equals zero. Because you see, if beta is different from zero, you get, at least if you confine your study to this theory, you get a ghost. But if beta is zero, this theory has no ghost, and is actually dual to a standard theory of gravity coupled to a massive scalar field. Where, however, the scalar field has not only a mass, it has a very well-defined potential. There is a similar counting in supersymmetric. This counting actually matches the number of off-shell gravitational degrees of freedom. You see that if you have a spin 2 and a spin 0, you have a total of six degrees of freedom. Well, 6 degrees of freedom is the number which you get taking a symmetric tensor, G mu nu, which has 10 degrees of freedom, and subtracting 4 gauge symmetries, which are the diffeomorphism. So what happens is that the counting of these massive states, which come from R plus R squared gravity, exactly coincide with the number of off-shell degrees of freedom of the graviton. And this counting works also in supersymmetry. And in supersymmetry, this counting is what gives you the spectrum of the supersymmetric generalization of the Starobinsky model. Well, at the level of n equal 1, this R plus R squared theory were derived in the late 80s in papers by Cecotti, which I also think was a student in Scuola Normale, if I... He was? He was a student of whom?
Was a student.
Yeah, but who was his advisor?
I think it was Luciano.
Luciano? Okay, so you see there are many people from Scuola Normale in this work. There is many people from Scuola Normale. There is Cecotti, and there is Massimo, which now is a distinguished professor at New York University. At that time, I think he was in Berkeley, probably. In 1988, Massimo, you were in Berkeley? Were you in Berkeley in 1988? Let me tell you about the story about the degree of freedom. The basic observation is that the massive excitation of supergravity induced by quadratic term in the curvature is identical to the number of off-shell degrees of freedom of the gravitational field. And in the case of supersymmetry, it will be the off-shell degrees of freedom of the supergravity multiplet. Well, this is the counting I was making before. You see, G mu nu has 10 degrees of freedom. You subtract 4 by diffeomorphism, you get 6. And you see that 6 is 1 plus 5. This is the scalaron, and this is the spin 2 ghost. This counting works in all kinds of theories with an arbitrary number of supersymmetries, and that allows you to identify the degree of freedom of the multiplet of the theory with higher derivative, which otherwise would be very complicated. Now let's take similar counting in n equal 1 supergravity. You have the graviton, which we saw has 6 degrees of freedom. The gravitino has 12 degrees of freedom because it is a Rita Schwinger field, so it has 4 spinor and 4 vector component. But you subtract 4 spinors because of local supersymmetry. And then you get 16 minus 4, which is 12. And so you see that in order to have a off-shell completion of supersymmetry, you need 6 bosonic degrees of freedom, which in standard Einstein gravity should not propagate. These are the so-called auxiliary fields. It is not surprising that this auxiliary field in R plus R squared gravity will propagate and will complete the massive multiplet which are deduced from this analysis. And so this is the result in the case of n equal 1 R plus R squared supergravity. The Weyl tensor square give you a spin 2 ghost multiplet, and you see that the spin 2 ghost multiplet contain a spin 2 and a spin 1. And then there is a spin 1 physical multiplet, depending whether you are in an old minimal and new minimal formulation, because there are two formulations with six auxiliary fields. One is called a new minimal, and the other is called all minimal. They have both number of multiplets, which are four bosons and four fermions. The difference is that in one case, you get two chiral multiplet, in the other case, you get one massive vector multiplet. These multiplets must be the multiplets which contain the scalaron, which contain this R plus R squared bosonic degrees of freedom. So so you see that in the two chiral multiplet case, the scalaron must be one of the four scalar which are here. In the case, instead of a vector multiplet, there is a unique identification, but because there is only one scalar around. There are no other scalar. So this scalar in the n equal 1 supergravity, which is formulated with auxiliary field, which are called new minimal formulation, is uniquely identified with this field. In the other formulation, it is one of the four scalars which appear here. You can do a similar trick in n equal 2. In n equal 2, the Weyl multiplet must give you the spin 2 ghost, which is a massive spin 2 representation. Massive spin 2 representation, n equal 2, has a lot of states. And then there is the R square, which by subtraction has the number of states. Why I can predict these states? Because I know in n equal 2 the full set of auxiliary field. So I know the off-shell formulation of the supergraviton. And the off-shell formulation of the supergraviton contains, it was derived in the 80s by De Witt, Van Holten, and also Van Prooyen, and later we derived this counting with Van Prooyen. There are 40 plus 40 degrees of freedom, 40 bosons from 40 fermions, and you can see exactly that these degrees of freedom split in a spin 2 ghost, which you disregard, because this is, that, and the other, which is the supersymmetric generalization of R square, which in n equal 2 case give you two massive multiplets, two massive vector multiplets. You see that this counting here, one vector, four spin, one half, and five scalar, twice is 8 plus 8, 8 plus 8, because you delete the ghost multiplet. And then you get that the R plus R square, n equal 2, supergravity will have two massive multiplet. And then you see that there are 10 scalar here. So the scalaron will be one of these 10 scalar. The scalaron which in the bosonic theory come from R plus R square here will be one of the five scalar which are partner of the massive spin 1 in this counting of states. So let me now review for a moment, because then I'm going to tell you what happened in a supersymmetric case. Let me review in a moment the Starobinsky theory. The Starobinsky theory starts with this Lagrangian here. Now, in order to show that this is equivalent to a massive spin 1 with a definite potential, you introduce a Lagrange multiplier, sigma and lambda. So you see that if you vary with respect to sigma, you get a lambda equal R, and this Lagrangian becomes the same. What is it? Do you have a pointer? Because this doesn't work. Ma non è luminoso questo.
No, quello no. Però questo sì, c'è ancora batteria.
Ok, these are the Lagrange multiplier. If you integrate over sigma, you get lambda equal R, you get this theory. The dual theory is obtained not integrating with respect to sigma, but rewriting this Lagrangian in a different way. And the way you write that Lagrangian is observing that sigma is multiplied by R. So sigma is essentially a modification of the Einstein term in the so-called Jordan frame. And then you see that now you can vary scale 1 plus sigma factor, and you get this using this identity. And then, because of the metric get multiplied by factor 1 plus sigma, the Firbine, when multiplied by this factor, you find that the equivalent theory is given by this action here. You get Einstein canonically normalized field, and then the potential. And this potential is the inflaton potential derived from Starobinsky.
This is the R
This is the Lagrangian after having
is in the new metric.
In the new metric. In the metric, yeah, because this Lagrangian is in the in this metric frame. So you have to go back to the Einstein frame. And in gravitation, all cosmological gravitation is done in the Einstein frame with canonically normalized inflatons. So the crucial point is that you have the Einstein term, and you have the inflaton which is canonically normalized. Then the potential, that potential there, why describe inflation? Well, you describe inflation because if you plot this, potential is given by this formula. There is a plateau here, which is the de Sitter inflation, and then there is this slow roll. And the interesting fact is that this cosmological parameter, which I was talking about, which are epsilon eta, only fill this factor in this exponential. And this factor in this exponential is related to this famous 2 over 3, which I was talking about before. Now, what is the supersymmetric generalization of this? Well, I told you already, there are two supersymmetric generalizations of this action. One is the one where this potential is somehow a truncation of a potential of two chiral multiplet. That is the formulation of R², which was made actually by Sergio Cecotti. There is another formulation, which is a formulation instead in which this R², introduce a massive multiplet as degree of freedom. And then in that case, there is only one scalar, because a massive multiplet contains only one scalar. And this scalar is precisely the inflaton. And not surprisingly, the supersymmetric version of R², contains an unmodified potential. It contains exactly the Swarovski potential, without any correction or any inclusion. What is this potential from the point of view of supersymmetry? From the point of view of supersymmetry, this potential is what is called a D-term, because it's a potential which a massive vector has. And the massive vector, if you write in the Stueckelberg way, is essentially a gauge, corresponds to a gauge, an object which absorbs through an X-like effect, a massless scalar. And then in that formulation of massive vector multiplet, you discover that this object is nothing like what usually is called D-term. But most importantly, the factor one, which is here, which is the one which gives the Sitter phase, because when phi goes to infinity, this term goes to zero and you get this one. This one is what in supersymmetry is called a Fayeli-Opulos term. Is the Fayeli-Opulos term related to the D term of this massive multiplet Lagrangian? I mean, okay. So let me go. So what is the Stueckelberg supergravity inflaton Lagrangian which describe this theory? Well, the bosonic part of this Lagrangian is written in this way. You see, this is what is called the supersymmetric Stueckelberg Lagrangian. This Lagrangian was actually derived by Van Prooyen at the very early stage of supersymmetry in the 80s. It contains this field C, which is essentially the inflaton. Is the inflaton written in a different coordinate system. There is a scalar field C, there is a massive vector B, and there is the Einstein term, and you see there is the kinetic term of the C field, which is related to the mass of the vector field, and is also related to the potential. But this Lagrangian contains all possible gauging of a single chiral multiplet. So it is a Stueckelberg. If I introduce a shift symmetry, which is just a shift in this way, what is not obvious is that this Lagrangian acquire a complex structure. Acquire a complex structure because you can join this C with the B, which is the longitudinal degree of freedom of the vector. And then you discover, not surprisingly, that in terms of C and B, the Lagrangian has a nice form of a gauge sigma model coupled to a complex chiral multiplet, not surprisingly. The interesting fact is that in this formula, the potential is given J prime C, and this J prime C is essentially the D term. And a term linear in J give a constant in J prime. So a term linear in J corresponds to what I call the Fayeli-Obolos term. And the Fayeli-Obolos term is what in this Starobinsky model gives you the anti-de Sitter phase. Without that constant term, it would not be possible. Excuse me? De Sitter. Yeah, yeah. Because D term do not give a negative potential. Here there are a series of formulae which relate the C field to the phi field. Why these formulae are important? Because these formulae are the one which relate the C field, which is not canonically normalized, to the phi field, which is the field used in inflation, which is the canonically normalized field. And then you get a series of relations which relate this D term, which here is called P, with this normalization here. Now, the last thing I want to say simply is that supersymmetry allows to introduce a hidden complex structure, not surprisingly, because this term can be written in this way, and then introducing a complex field W, which is IC minus B, you get the supergravity Lagrangian written in a standard Keller form. There is an interesting fact that in the Starobinsky model, if you compute the curvature of the scalar manifold, one-dimensional scalar manifold, which come from this R plus R square theory, you find that the curvature is constant and negative. So it is the gauging of an SL2R symmetry. You see that SL2R appear again, not only in three dimensions, but they appear also in four dimensions. Namely, in the Starobinsky model, there is an SL2R induced by gravity, and the gauge Stuckelberg symmetry, which makes the multiplet massive, is one of the isometry of SL2R. Now, SL2R has three kinds of isometries. There is one elliptic isometry, which is U1. There is an hyperbolic isometry, which is SO11. And there is a parabolic isometry, which is that corresponds to the translation, because it's the generalization of a standard Zuckerberg. Use an arbitrary function here, and then you can gauge three different kinds of isometries. And the interesting fact is that this potential reproduces models known in inflation. For instance, if you take R equals 0, which corresponds to I, because the third derivative is 0, then the manifold becomes, there is no longer SL2R, the manifold becomes flat. This model contains the chaotic inflation model which Bali was describing today, namely a potential which is just m squared phi squared. If you take instead a constant R, you get one particular case is the Starobinsky model which corresponds to the gauging of the parabolic isometry. However, if you gauge the other isometries, you get different inflaton potential which correspond to combination of cosine and hyperbolic cosine. So there is an interesting fact that from the point of view of cosmology, this factor square root of 2 over 3 is related to the curvature of the Keller manifold, while the constant factor which produces the de Sitter inflationary phase correspond to the Fayeli-Obolos term of this massive vector multiplet. Now you see that in principle you can modify this theory departing from the Starobinsky model where R is constant, taking an arbitrary P, then R is not constant. But of course you can in principle deform this function to be almost constant, because in principle you can make a continuous deformation of this function here. In that case, there will be only one isometry, not three isometry, in the Keller manifold, and depending which isometry you assume in the manifold, you will have different Keller potential and different inflationary potential. So I am thinking, I think I am just at the end. What I wanted just to show you is that there is a generalization to supersymmetry of this Starobinsky potential. The generalization has two, there are two ways of making this generalization, but in one way it is particularly simple, because the scalar potential depends only on a single real scalar field, something that from the point of view of supersymmetry would seem impossible. But it is in fact possible, because the scalar field, you have to think that is a component of a massive vector. So it's essentially the super-Stugelberg generalization of the Stugelberg mechanism. You see, the Stugelberg mechanism is essentially what makes a massless vector to be massive. In supersymmetry, however, a massive vector multiplet with respect to the massless case has an extra scalar. So this extra scalar is precisely the scalar we are talking about here. Then there are let me just mention this come later. Well, these are the people who have worked recently in this supersymmetric completion of R plus R square models. In particular, this new minimal approach was also investigated by Farakos, Keagias, and Riotto. And then there are a series of papers which unfortunately are not correct by Ketov and others. Unfortunately, there is one paper by Ketov and Starobinsky. And then there are other papers which are in some sense correct, but they depart from, which has Ellis, Nanopoulos, Olive, and others, where they try to supersymmetrize not R plus R square, but the dual theory. Namely, they go to the model dualizing the R plus R square in a standard theory, and then try to supersymmetrize the standard theory. The thing actually do not commute. So if you call the model R plus R square, I think the correct way to do it is to try to supersymmetrize R plus R square, namely to supersymmetrize a theory which has only the gravitational degrees of freedom. As I say, these gravitational degrees of freedom, however, have a rich structure because of the auxiliary field. The auxiliary field enter in this game, and they enter in order to reproduce the correct counting of massive states. And on the other hand, however, they also introduce in the dual theory a theory which has a Keller potential, a superpotential, like a standard supergravity without extra derivative terms. And this is, I think, is the end of my talk, and I would like just to repeat best wishes, Riccardo.
Sergio, I didn't understand. Do you view this R plus R squared as a fundamental theory or as
an effective theory?
But then, if it's an effective theory, then why?
The inflaton potential cannot be a fundamental theory.
But then why, if it's an effective theory, are you making a claim that the results are going to be independent of adding further curvature invariants?
Well, I think you can make the same argument for the standard cosmology. The standard cosmology is based on Einstein theory. I mean, the standard cosmology and the standard inflaton potential, forgetting supersymmetry, is made using Friedman, Demeter, Robertson, Walker in gravity, and making some prediction.
In that case, there are infinitely many potentials one can make, and nobody is making the claim that one is more interesting than the other. Well,
no,
here we are focusing on this one. Is this more interesting than the other ones?
The focus is because it is a potential which has, in some sense, is unique in the sense that it comes. In principle, you can write whatever you like.
Yeah. How about R to the fourth?
Up to the fourth term, you can add and you can supersymmetrize, and but they do not ruin because of the number of the Hubble parameter and so on. You can see that they don't ruin this.
Yeah, but is it going to change the predictions or not?
Oh, they're going to change. I didn't have the time actually. I had the full set of transparencies on not only R to the four, by R to the n terms.
Okay.
And their supersymmetrization. They have been, in our model, they haven't been studied. And they don't make, if you introduce the numbers, they don't make a sensible change to these predictions.
No unique prediction.
Well, there is no unique prediction because this higher R term, you can fix whatever you like. You could take string theory.
I'm hoping that somehow in supersymmetry the situation is better. Maybe there is some preferred prediction. But if you're saying it's just like...
Well, in supersymmetry, the prediction is unique up to the R square term. If I make higher R square term, there is a unique prediction of the structure. But of course, the coefficient is like when you were talking about the operator expansion, you have infinitely many terms. You must have something else in order to fix.
How many parameters?
String theory would fix those terms.
Exactly. How many parameters?
Supersymmetric between the supersymmetric.
But what is n equals zero?
Well, you can
n equals zero. Okay.
Some
yes.
Scalar tensor theory of gravity with an arbitrary potential or an arbitrary f of r.
Yes.
They are one equivalent to the other. Is there any more? Are there any more constraints in supersymmetry than in n equals zero?
If you take this d term construction, you get exactly the same theory. If you get, however, the construction we use instead of a massive vector multiplet, you use two chiral multiplet, which is the formulation which is called all minimal supergravity, the one of Chagoti, then there is a freedom. Actually, it's less restricted, the supersymmetric. It's less restricted. You can add extra term, which in term of a dual theory correspond to a superpotential term. And
sure. Let's say you only have a real scalar.
Excuse me?
If you only have a real scalar, which is the...
No, if you have a real scalar, which is the one I did, you get exactly the same result. The only thing, of course, is that you predict a new state, which is this vector field, which is present in the theory. But the nice thing is to see this, the origin of the term in the potential in terms of the supersymmetric data. I mean, the constant term is a Fayet-Leopoulos term, and this term in the exponential is related to the curvature of the Keller manifold. That I think is an interesting fact.
At one loop, you also get the other term that gives the ghost. Is this a problem?
Well, it is a problem. Well, in principle, unless...
To a loop, you get the other term. No, basically, you are setting to zero a coefficient, which means setting the mass of the ghost to infinity. You do a quantum correction, it is no longer set to this value. Okay, so... No. Here, you have made one choice of parameter such that one mass is infinity. This is not stable. So... I am able to count.
No, it means that it gives a constraint on the whole renormalization group theory of your model. You should now, if you have this constraint of your energy, now you have to...
Let me tell you, for example, one thing. In n bigger than 4, this term by square is actually absent for reason of supersymmetry. If you take n bigger than 4, you can show...
One modest gain that you have when you use this new minimal formalism is that certain high curvature corrections that are allowed in non-supersymmetric theories should not appear if you impose reasonable constraints on your theory. In particular, if you think that you normalize to one the term, the Einstein term, so you have R with a coefficient in front, then the Starobinsky term will carry some coupling constant, G minus 2 R squared. The term R to the 4 will carry, in general, G minus 6, but actually that term is not allowed in this new minimal formalism if you ask your theory to become regular in the limit G goes to 0. It should. I mean, in the dual formulation, when you send the coupling constant to 0, your massive vector, auxiliary field, becomes massless. Nothing more happens. If you want that to persist also with additive corrections, certain terms that you would allow instead are not present. And that, I mean, is a small gain, I think.
Maybe we should end here. Maybe I can make a remark that there is another interest in this kind of exercise. That in string theory, one is interested in computing supersymmetric completion of higher curvature terms, which of course are more general. And here, it's one is solving part of that problem in the Toynbee example. So I would like to thank all the speakers of, say, the day. And all the participants for being with us. And there will be a concert. But since we are slightly late, the break will be 15 minutes. So the concert will start at 7:30.